Fear Street Part 1, 1994 was funny, thrilling, violent, and ridiculous. Altogether, it was a lot of fun. We learned a lot from a rewatch, so let's dive deep into the details of the story, starting with everything that we learned from the intro credits. The story centers around the trial of the witch, Sarah Fier. Sarah was hung, but according to a nursery rhyme, before the witch's final breath, she found a way to cheat her death. By cutting off her wicked hand, she kept her grip upon the land. She reaches from beyond the grave to make good men her wicked slaves. She'll take your blood, she'll take your head. She'll follow you till you're dead. Samantha's visions show that the nursery rhyme is true. Sarah Fier's hand was cut off before she died by hanging. The witch has haunted Shadyside ever since, turning normal people into killers. In 1904, grifter guts girls. In 1922, child killer Billy Barker bashed his brother's heads in while they slept. And in 1935, the Humpty Dumpty killer. As you'll see, there's an underlying pattern of the killers being spurned suitors. Cyrus Fuller gutted three women at a tavern. In 1953, Harry Rooker, a deviant milkman, slew seven women between the ages of 22 and 35. In 1965, Ruby Lane murdered her boyfriends and her friends, then she cut her wrist and died singing a song about her boyfriend, accusing him of being adulterous. In 1978, there was the Camp Nightwing massacre, which, by the looks of the final scene, may have been related to boy drama of some sort, involving and maybe even between C. Berman and her sister. And in the current timeline, Heather rejected Ryan and he killed her. Similarly, Samantha and Dina both felt rejected, which may explain why both of their noses bled, and at the end, Samantha had flies around her, she was possessed, and she tried to kill Dina. So it is quite possible that rejection factors into the original story with the witch, Sarah Fier. Since the witch often possesses spurned suitors, the witch herself may have been a spurned suitor. And one has to wonder if Josh's online friend, the Queen of Air and Darkness, is the witch, Sarah Fier. If so, let's hope that Josh doesn't reject her since she seems to have a thing for him. Now let's discuss the two towns, the Good Family, and the first recorded tragedy, which happened in 1666. In 1666, Pastor Cyrus Miller snapped. He killed kids and cut out their eyes. This article clipping states that Solomon Good pledged assistance to the families. As you can see by this kid's jersey, the Millers are still local, and so are the Goods, which we will get to in a minute. In 1978, 16 years before the story, 12 people were killed at the Camp Shadyside massacre. And who owned the camp? The Good family. After the massacre, the Good family demolished the old camp and made way for the Shadyside Mall. That is where the opening scene took place. Heather rejected Ryan, a fly landed on him, he was possessed, and then he killed seven people, including Heather. Then the sheriff killed Ryan, and not just any sheriff, but Sheriff Nick Good of the Good family. Sheriff Good is the sheriff of Shadyside, a town with so much violence that it has earned itself a nickname, Killer Capital, USA. The neighboring town is Sunnyvale, a town which has not had a crime in 30 years. Sunnyvale's mayor is Sheriff Good's brother, Will Good. Mayor Will Good's name is interesting, not just because of the name Good, but because his first name is Will, and a will is something that one writes before their death. After the bus and the car crash scene, Sheriff Good told Dina,
"I'm on your side,"
which is the kind of thing a police officer would say to everyone. But there may be more than that. The sheriff may have been referring to the fact that Peter was a snobby Sunnyvale kid, whereas Dina was from Shadyside. And there may even be a familial divide between Sheriff Good and his brother, Mayor Good, possibly even originating back to camp. And we may have had two clues as to what happened at the camp massacre. Sheriff Good asked Dina if
maybe you were just goofing around. Things got out of hand.
And literally, the very first line of Fear Street Part 1 is,
"It began as a prank and ended in murder."
Let's see if those two lines turn out to be allusions as to what happened at the Camp Nightwing massacre. Speaking of the massacre, there was one Shadyside survivor, C. Berman. Amidst the carnage, C. Berman saw the witch, just like Samantha saw the witch. That was 16 years ago, and C. Berman is still alive, so how did she do it? Technically, she died. Her heart stopped and a local boy performed CPR, bringing her back to life. The nursery rhyme says, "She'll take your blood, she'll take your head, she'll follow you until you're dead." So when C. Berman died, the curse against her was broken. And the same thing happened for Samantha. When Dina drowned Samantha, the killers disappeared. Then Dina and Josh brought Samantha back to life with the EpiPens and CPR, just like C. Berman and Simon's brother. But Samantha's temporary death didn't finish off the witch. The witch still has power, so she possessed Samantha and tried to kill Dina. Dina was able to detain the possessed Samantha, and now Dina and Josh have met up with C. Berman, who is telling them what happened at the camp in 1978. We will get details as to what actually happened in Fear Street Part 2 next week. But in the meantime, let's review the outstanding questions. We know the identities of Skull Mask and Ruby Lane, but who is the man behind the Nightwing mask? The man behind the Camp Nightwing massacre? And more importantly, who is the person in this robe? The person has two hands, so it may not actually be the witch, but rather someone who is assisting the witch. Could these little hands be Mayor Will Good's hands? And what about the note that Sheriff Nick Good left saying, "It's happening again"? Whose house was that? And why did he stop himself from knocking? Something's up with whoever lives there. And what about Dina? Samantha's nose bled both times that she had visions of Sarah. But Dina's nose bled first. Was Dina possessed at that time? Is that why she threw the water cooler? And even if not, is Dina connected to the witch? Will Dina be possessed in part 2? Janitor Martin was locked up for spray painting something at the mall. What did he spray paint? Did he unknowingly summon the witch by painting something like this little symbol here? If so, then Josh may regret giving him the paperclip because Martin may go paint that same sign again. And last but not least, how can they stop the witch?
Maybe it's her missing hand.
That might be it. Maybe they need to find the missing hand and return it to Sarah Fier's resting spot. We'll do another one like this for parts 2 and 3 of Fear Street, but until then, catch you on the flip side.